Is it important?
It's very crucial.
Groovy.
Little stereo.
I'll say kick it, and you'll just kick it with a tasty groove, okay? 1, 2, 3, kick it.
Woo!
Oh, hi, Mark.
Oh, he likes.
It's time for the most crucial podcast with your host, me, Mark Franchise.
Meh, meh, meow.
All right, welcome to the most crucial podcast. It is Mark Franchise, 104.9 The Edge. Today, extremely special guest, a guy I've seen in concert about 6 times now. Completely blown away every time I see him, a part of one of the biggest bands in American rock history. Talking about Chicago, here with Keith Holland, guitar player for Chicago. Thanks for hanging out, man. I appreciate it.
Hey, no worries. Good to be here.
So you grew up basically in Virginia. You started playing guitar when you were a kid, right?
Yeah, I think I first picked up guitar when I was 7 years old, living in Silver Spring, Maryland. It's actually an incorrect statement. I guess I was really born and raised in Maryland.
Okay.
It was Silver Spring, Maryland, but then I spent a lot of years in Virginia as well, so.
Gotcha. When you were a kid and you were growing up listening to music, you're more into, like, rock, weren't you? Like hard rock?
Well, I mean, my older brother, Craig, is almost 4 years older than me. And his ear led him more towards jazz and R&B and, some of the more proggy stuff. He was into jazz. And I was sort of... being a guitar player, I was coming up listening to, Kiss. You know, that was one of the albums that I bought. I didn't even know what they sounded like. I just saw the album cover and saw the makeup and the smoke, and I went,
yeah.
Wow, this was cool, you know? So I bought the first Kiss Live record and listening to Ted Nugent and, you know, guitar players, but more, more rock stuff. And what started to happen, though, which was interesting, was my older brother... Every Christmas would buy me records that he thought I should have and I should like, but left to my own designs, I might not choose.
That's interesting.
So he turned me on to Toto, Jeff Beck, Journey. We're still in sort of a rock vein, but I remember he bought me the first Toto record, on almost the day it came out. I'd never heard of Jeff Beck. He got Blow by Blow. The first Journey records that had Steve Perry on it. So he turned me on to a lot of music. Plus in the house, he was constantly playing Chicago and Earth, Wind & Fire and Blood, Sweat & Tears and The Crusaders and, different stuff like that, Weather Report. But I do vividly remember the day he brought home Chicago 2 because his drum instructor told him he needed to learn all of Danny Sarafian's drum parts. And we just sat in his room and listened to that thing top to bottom. And I just remember thinking, this is the most interesting and different stuff I've ever heard.
That album in general is on another level. I'm right there with you, where I had an older brother myself and kind of fed into what he was listening to. I also had a father who grew up hardcore listening to Chicago, Santana, The Who, Blues Brothers. I was raised on all of that. And that second Chicago album has always spoken to me. Something about that album is incredibly special. And the fact that they gave him the daunting task of trying to replicate Danny Sarafian's drumming on that is kind of cruel.
Yeah, well, you know what? It's funny because, my brother is actually a great drummer.
Really?
And a lot of his foundation was Danny's playing. He really, really steeped himself in Danny's playing. And then I actually, believe it or not, got to return the favor. I came home with I was studying jazz guitar with this guy in Roanoke, Virginia, and he laid on me a Chick Corea album called The Leprechaun.
Huh.
And it had a drummer on there named Steve Gadd, who, I don't know if you know Steve Gadd, but he's probably one of the most recorded drummers in history. He played with Eric Clapton and Paul Simon. And,
wow.
A lot of jazz records, and he's in James Taylor's band now, but I remember giving my brother that album and going, what do you think of this guy? Listen to this guy, and my brother listened to it, and all of a sudden he was just all Steve Gadd, so I returned the favor a few years later.
That's great. You had a lot of experience. Obviously, you moved to L.A. to seek a a profession in music. I know you had gone to school actually out there as well, but you had had opportunities to tour with Olivia Newton-John, and really your first on the road experience was with Rick Springfield, correct?
Yeah, that is correct. And it's funny because when I toured with Rick, it really was. I mean, it was about 3 months. I think that was about the extent of it. We did go overseas. We went to Japan. And, you know, it felt like a really long summer.
Yeah.
In a good way. A lot of fun. His music is very guitar intensive, you know, so a lot of solos, a lot of fun stuff to play. The funny thing, though, is go on YouTube and you put in Rick Springfield, Solana Beach, California.
Okay.
Just north of San Diego. This thing just popped up just a few months ago. It's a full concert of me playing with Rick in 1993.
Oh, that's wild.
And the weird part of it is it wasn't there. There was nothing. I've searched high and low. I had no recordings of me playing with him, no videos, no nothing. And then all of a sudden, this whole concert popped up on YouTube. I sat and watched myself one night, and it was really surreal because it was like a different guy. I was like, who is that guy?
Oh, no doubt.
Because it was so long ago, and I was so young and kind of naive, and it was just funny to watch it.
That was also your first experience, too, with a larger crowd. It was like almost night and day from what you were accustomed to as far as live performances were concerned.
Oh, absolutely. And I've shared this story before, but, I went into rehearsals with Rick, and we worked at the show. But I hadn't gone to see him live, so I didn't know what to expect of what his audience would be like.
Yeah.
That he would be like on stage, or so we're up in San Francisco at a club called Slim's, which actually is, I believe, owned by Bob Skaggs. And we were down in the lower level, which is where the dressing rooms are, and everybody's kind of getting dressed and warming up, and Rick's standing there. And I walked over to him and I said, "Hey, Rick," I said, "What's it going to be like up there?" He looked at me and he said, "You'll see, new guy." And we walked out on that stage, and it was like freaking Beatlemania.
Oh, that's wild.
Yeah. I'm not kidding you. The crowd was louder than the band, and it was all girls screaming. It was pretty wild. It was funny, too, because as soon as we hit the stage and the crowd erupted like that, he just kind of shot me a look and kind of smiled like, "There you go, new guy."
New guy. Oh, man. Fast forward a couple of years, really how you got involved with Chicago. I know that you have a guy, Dave Friedman, who worked at Third Encore, which is like a rehearsal studio in North Hollywood. And I know that you had altercation, but there was a moment where you had seen Jason Scheff, the former bass player who replaced Peter Cetera in the 80s with Chicago, and you had kind of seen him and kind of threw him a half, pitched him like a half joke, half serious, like, "Hey, you know, you guys ever need a guitar player? What up?" And then you inquired to Dave Friedman when you were trying to find any kind of gig possible. He called you the next day and was like, "Hey, Chicago's here." And you were like, "Great. Like, I got to do this right now." And you just luckily ran into him outside. You again were kind of like, "Hey, remember me?" And he's like, "No, not really."
Right. Well, the timeline on that really is I was at Third Encore rehearsing with an original band project. And the drummer in that band, a guy named Sergio Gonzalez, was friends with Jason.
Okay.
And Chicago was in a different room doing pre-production for the big band record.
Oh, wow.
And so Jason came down the hall and poked his head in, you know, and listened to us play for a little while. And we took a break, and Jason and Sergio were talking, and Sergio introduced me to Jason. And I said, "Man, big fan, love the band. You guys ever need a guitar player, I'm your guy, you know."
Yeah.
And he laughed, and then he left. And it was about 3 months later that I called Friedman, and he told me that Chicago was down there auditioning guitar players, like, right then. And I literally almost hung the phone up and and turned the TV on and poured another cup of coffee. And,
yeah.
You know, it was a closed audition. It was already in motion. Something got better at me, and I threw all my gear in my car and I drove down there and I watched each guy one by one walk into the rehearsal studio, and literally I was like, oh, there's Robert Lamb, I can't talk to him. There's Lee Lockhand, I can't talk to him. There's Jimmy Pankow, I can't talk to him. And the station finally showed up last, and like you said, I jumped out and I said, hey, remember me? He said, no. And then I was in that band with Sergio. Remember Sergio? And he goes, oh, yeah, I do. And he said, yeah, let me see what I can do. And he talked guys into listening to me. And so that was that. It's almost 25 years ago.
It's phenomenal.
25 January, yeah.
And Chicago is celebrating 50 years today since the first album came out, correct?
I think that's right. I know that there's anniversary of the band. I think it's 53 years, February.
Okay. Yeah, because I think it was like 67 or something when they initially started out around that time.
Right. I think it was February of 67 was when they all got together and shook hands and said, we're gonna stick with this thing and see what we can do. And
right.
They did pretty good for themselves, didn't they?
It was really confidence in your playing that really landed you the gig with Chicago, wasn't it?
Well, I think what it really was a sort of threefold. You know, Jason told me after the fact, I wasn't obviously in the room when they were auditioning the other guitar players, but he said, some guys were great soloists but couldn't sing. Some guys were great singers but couldn't solo. Some guys were great singers and soloists, but they were, maybe didn't look what the band was looking for. And he said, that I came in and I played the 70s stuff like the 70s stuff needs to be played. I had all the 80s stuff pretty nailed because I was a big Steve Lukather and Michael Landau fan. So I had sort of a Chicago 16 and 17 sounds and tones. I sang, I was young, and they probably knew by how excited I was that they could probably have me for a pizza and a six pack of beer. So, all that thrown together.
Yeah.
I was good.
It's really a no-brainer when you look at it like that, because that's one thing that I've always been blown away by. Like I said, I think I've seen Chicago now 6 times, and it's hard when you grow up with an album. Changes happen in bands. That's just the nature of it. Some bands are more fortunate than others when it comes to lineup changes. With other bands, it's necessary. Those changes come out of necessity rather than convenience. But through that, the heart of the band is really what's most important. If you truly feel like the spirit of the band is continuing through different artists, then there's no reason that a band should ever stop or should ever quit. That's my opinion on it. And all I've ever known in live music from Chicago is the lineup that I've seen multiple times. And like I said, every single time, I think the last time I saw you guys was at DTE Energy Music Theater in Clarkston when you guys teamed with Earth, Wind, and Fire. That is just a colossal team that you guys have. I think the continuity between you and a band like Earth, Wind, and Fire and a band like Doobie Brothers as well, between your three bands, it seems like this just pure connection with one another and a pure understanding of each other's music. And it's so special to see all of you guys come together on the stage. You don't see anything like that.
Yeah, the funny part of it is sort of music transcends everything, in terms of, when you get together with another band like Doobies or Earth, Wind, and Fire, you're dealing with pros and you share such common ground of what your life is and how you travel. And there's just a level of respect and understanding and nonverbal communication,
Yeah.
So when you're on stage with another band like that, there's another band of really, really top-notch, pro, seasoned musicians. It just, that could be, when you get 23 guys on stage, whatever it is, 22 or however many we were, there's potential for a major train wreck right there.
No doubt.
But everybody is so mature musically that it doesn't happen, So it's really, that's one of the things that's been really, really, really cool for me.
Yeah.
Is since I, got this gig, I've gotten to actually get on stage and perform with a lot of other bands that were, heroes of mine growing up, whether it was Earth, Wind, or Doobies, or REO Speedwagon.
Yeah.
Free Lewis in the News. You know, I mean, we've got Peter Frampton. Didn't play with Peter, but we toured with him. Crosby, Stills, and Nash. I mean, I've got Paul and Oates. I've got to hang out, meet, and play with a lot of artists that I grew up listening to just on the coattails of being in Chicago.
Yeah.
It's just really fun.
But in all respect, though, I feel like your spot was earned, because I don't think there's a guitar player out there who could perfectly emulate that soul and feeling that you put into those Terry Kath solos. And at the same time, like you said, when it comes to the 80s stuff, it's like, boom, you flick a switch and you're right there. You understood the sound of, I guess you could call it both eras of Chicago, because, you know, there was the Terry Kath era, and then after he passed away, the sound and direction of the band obviously changed a little bit. I mean, I feel like that's the reason why you've been there for 24 years. I don't think they're going to find anybody who can really capture that feeling like you can. And like I said, I've done a tremendous job over the years.
I don't know whether there's not anybody out there that could do it. I'm sure there's plenty of guys that could do it, but you know, I'm here, and it seemed to work out.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, and it really wasn't anything more than just pure coincidence that, you know, that I was a fan of their music, and I grew up listening to Terry Kath, and then, like I said, I sort of went down a rabbit hole in the 80s, you know, listening to, you know, Toto, and started buying all the records Steve Lukather played on and Michael Landau played on. And those are the guys who played on the 80s era Chicago records.
So yeah.
I just had that all on my palate already.
Music has changed so much. Obviously, the focus of mainstream music has completely shifted. I think we saw that going into the late 70s, going into the 80s too, how the musical eye shifted from rock and roll to pop. And especially nowadays, there's a huge focus on hip hop and pop. And I feel like it's becoming more difficult for rock bands to get their name out there. So what I'm starting to see are more bands doing it kind of the old school way, doing it their way, doing it underground, and doing it themselves. And I feel like that's really the future of rock music. And I don't know if you see it that way yourself as well, but I feel like it's harder and harder for a rock band, a really creative rock band, to get out there and to market their music to a large audience, because I feel like, if you want to call it the music industry, but the eye of the music industry just kind of used rock and roll for what they could get out of it, and then just kind of jumped over to pop music. And I wasn't alive back then, but growing up with music and the history of bands and just kind of looking back, that's the overall feel that I'm getting from it.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I think in this day and age, because of the fact that it's very difficult to market and sell records anymore.
Yeah.
You know, because as soon as you release something, it's all over the internet, and it's on streaming sites, and it's on YouTube, and so, you know, my kids don't expect to have to pay for music, because, you know, you pay $12 a month for Apple Music, and
yeah,
you can listen to whatever you want, you know. And so that's really cut the royalties that artists see. So kind of the new model, I think, is really more to get out there and pound the pavement and play live shows.
Yeah.
And generate a following that way. You know, and the funny part of it is, it's kind of come full circle, because that's how you had to do it in the 70s, was you put a band together, you rehearsed it till you were good, you played clubs until people came to see you, and then when the crowd grew, then the record label would pay attention to you, and they'd sign you, and then it would go from there. So nowadays, it's kind of the same deal. You got to go out there and establish your audience and pound the pavement and play, and, you know, and if, you know, things go well, then maybe a label will pick you up. You know, I mean, there's exceptions to that. You know,
yeah, no doubt. And that's the thing, too. I feel like when bands made music back then, especially put out records, every song in the album meant something. There was nothing on the album that you weren't 100% invested in. If you didn't believe in it, it wasn't going to make the record. And I feel like that's something also that's kind of missing from music today, is that music is just kind of disposable. People are more concerned about a single that they can sell on iTunes rather than writing an album and sitting down and saying, okay, let's create something here. And I think that's another big thing that's missing from music now too. It's just a bunch of random songs. And there, I feel like there's still bands out there that are doing it that way, where they want to write an album, they want to put it out, they want it to mean something. But I feel like that's another issue with music today, is that it's just throw singles out there.
Well, I mean, just the whole motivation behind making music for a lot of artists nowadays is different than it was back then.
True.
You know, when Jimmy wrote The Ballet for a Girl in Buckhannon,
yeah,
it contained their first big single, Make Me Smile. He wasn't trying to write a hit record. He was writing a 13-minute piece of music that he thought was cool.
Yeah.
And it was, there was no preconceived, you know, oh, I got to write a 3-minute pop song. You know, the record company plucked that out of that piece and put it on the radio, and he was as shocked as anybody that it was a hit. You know, that wasn't what they were trying to do. They were just trying to be creative. There's a band out right now that I really love, and it's instrumental stuff, and it's pretty jazz influenced. But a band called Snarky Puppy,
huh.
And if you haven't heard them, you could go check them out or hop on YouTube and watch some live stuff of them. They're
for sure
unbelievable. Probably, I can't remember how many pieces they had. It's a big band with horns and 3 guitar players, and, you know, talk about making music for the sake of making music. And they're really getting a huge following.
That's great.
I mean, playing instrumental jazz and selling out, you know, the Ryman Auditorium in Nashville, that's big. But there is hope.
Yeah, there definitely is. I've got a couple of buddies out here, some friends. There's a couple of bands in Michigan, the Gasoline Gypsies and the Native Howl, who have literally done everything themselves and are starting to get really big recognition, not only across the state, but nationally. And it's crazy because I've known these guys for 7 years now, and it started, you know, in my buddy Alex's late father's old heating and cooling building, and they completely transformed it into a recording studio. And everything they've done is just DIY. And now they're touring the country 2-3 times a year. And, it's just wild. People aren't giving up, and that's the good news. That's something we can kind of hold stock in.
That's cool.
So
if you know where to look and you poke around, there's a lot of great stuff happening now, and you know, and I don't think that's ever going to go away. You know, something that just popped into my head. We were talking about, you know, streaming sites and stuff being up on YouTube. You know, I remember when I was a kid, I remember, you know, having friends say like, "Hey, man, can you make me a cassette tape of that such and such an album."
Yeah.
And I remember feeling guilty about, well, you know, somebody's gonna not gonna get paid for this if I, you know, they should go buy the album.
Yeah.
And back then, you know, just making a tape of a record felt somehow wrong. And now everything is just so freely shared for free everywhere, you know, and the perception is that's perfectly fine. I don't totally get it, but what do we live in now?
I think on one hand it can be good because it can expose people to music they haven't heard before. I feel like if you really respect the artist and the art itself, you won't take advantage of something like that. And even recently, within the last few years, there's a band, Architects, out of the UK, who just have gone through so much personal grief and struggles within the last few years. And I was turned on to an album of theirs. And by the third song, I was like, I am going to get this album right now, and went to the record store, bought the album, and I was sold instantly. And I think that mentality still lives with people who have the respect for artists, who knows, like, that's their well-being. And for artists who literally put their minds on the line and they give everything to the performance and the music, it's only fair that you kind of help them out, you know, because that's their livelihood. That's how they're putting their personal lives on the line for you to enjoy or to to get some understanding from. And I think that's the only fair thing to do is, you know, buy the album, support them in ways that will help them out.
Yeah, I agree, because, you know, what I do a lot of times is, you know, I might go online and, you know, I say, oh, so-and-so has a new record out. I'll go listen to some of it. And if I think it's great, then I go buy it.
Yeah.
If that's, you know, if I don't like it, I kind of listen to some of it and I go, I don't think that's, you know, then I don't buy it.
Yeah.
But, and it used to be you had that opportunity too. You know, they'd actually have listening stations at record stores.
Oh, yeah.
You could, like, preview stuff and listen to it and decide whether you wanted to buy it or not. So
yeah.
I look at it more that way, because when you really think about it, $12 for maybe 10 songs that somebody spent tons and tons of hours creating and recording and mixing and mastering. And some people are like complaining about, well, I don't want to pay 99 cents for a song.
Yeah.
You know, that's less than a cup of coffee. I mean, come on.
Right.
Ridiculous. You know?
I think it's a matter of the convenience. I think people are just getting lazier. And that's the thing, like you mentioned before, that hard work ethic and that mentality of having the passion to write an album, it's never going to go away. The only thing is, now it's not gift-wrapped to you. You know, before it was gift-wrapped to you, because record labels and the music industry itself were recognizing all these incredible bands coming up in the 60s and the 70s, and they were throwing them at you, and you couldn't help but be overwhelmed. But now that they're not throwing them at you anymore, you know, it's the same people who, and I know they're huge over here, Ted Nugent, you know, Bob Seger, Kid Rock, they're huge over here, but I see the same people online complaining that there's no, you know, rock is dead, but then they're going to go and see Kid Rock four nights in a row, but not go to local music shows and discover new music. And it's a shame, because I'm constantly discovering new music, and it's nothing against those guys. They have to make a living too, obviously. But I think it's, you know, what's the convenience? What's in it for me? And the answer is new music, something different, you know? Something to inspire you.
Well, you know, I don't think rock will ever be dead. Music is cyclical in nature. You know, different sort of eras and sounds come back around. You know, I wouldn't be shocked if we don't see, you know, a resurgence again of hair bands with spandex and makeup. like 80s metal kind of stuff coming back around. You just never know.
Yeah.
It's generational. It's like, there's a lot of bands that put cover songs out of tunes from the 60s and the 70s, and the kids that are buying those records have no idea that they're cover songs. They just think that the new artist they're listening to wrote that song.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just devastated. I thought the Black Crowes' Hard to Handle was the song they wrote. And that's an old blues tune, you know?
Yeah.
So even I'm a victim to it.
Right. But I think it's helpful too that vinyl is making such a big resurgence, because now the mindset of listening to a record from beginning to end instead of just skipping through songs. You know, if I put a record on, I'm setting it and it goes. And I think that's great too. There are a lot of, especially where I live in Kalamazoo, there's a big vinyl scene. A lot of the local bands that are here put their music out on vinyl, because we have multiple record shops in the city as well. So
I just recently got a turntable and set of speakers and broke out my old vinyl collection, and it reminded me how different that experience is.
Yeah.
It really is. You know, it's a warmer sound, and it's also, you're right, it's more of a listening experience where you sit down. You know, so much of music today is listened to not in ideal, you know, what's the word I'm looking for, situations. You know, people listen to music off of their iPhone speaker. When I was a kid, you went out and you bought yourself a nice stereo system and put it in your room, and you sat on your bed and cranked it up and listened to records.
Yeah, absolutely.
And immersed yourself in it.
That was my first introduction to music, and my dad still got his stereo system hooked up in the basement. I was just lucky enough to, you know, grow up in that kind of setting.
I'll never forget. It was 1976. I think it was 1976, so I was 12 years old, and Boston had just released their first album, and I had not heard it. And this girl that was in my class in junior high school, who was one of the cuter girls in school, said, "Hey, my older brother has this really nice stereo and Phil and David speakers. I just got Boston's new album. Do you want to come over and listen to it?" And we sat in her brother's bedroom and listened to that record front to back, and I still remember it like it was yesterday.
Wow.
And I was nervous and freaking out because I was with a girl. but the music and the sound of it on that stereo just blew my mind.
Oh, yeah. That's funny. Yeah.
That's what music is supposed to do to you.
Yeah, if it's not doing that to you, you're not valuing what you have. It's music is one of the best creations the universe has ever come up with. It is universal. There are just sounds that you can create with music. It's its own language. It speaks to you in a way that words can't sometimes, and that's the beauty of it. And if you don't see it for that, you're really missing out.
Well, you know, and I will raise this point too. This popped into my head the other day too. If you watch any TV show, movie, any drama, anything like that, imagine for a minute when you're watching and you're watching the actors do this scene, especially in sort of, you know, emotional moments in the show or the movie, and you're being moved by the performance. Imagine taking away the soundtrack and only having the dialogue. Completely different experience.
Yeah, very true.
Not nearly as powerful. So much that you take for granted that you don't even realize is happening there. You know, the scoring of a movie is so critical.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah, I mean, music is, it's an emotional thing. It's been around since the dawn of man. It sort of transcends a lot of things, and I don't know anybody that says, "I don't like music."
Right.
You know what I mean? There's a lot of things, you know, you can say you don't like, but I don't really, if there's somebody out there that doesn't like music at all, that's pretty out there.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever experienced anything like that. So you guys are going into 50 years. You got this back-to-back shows in Chicago. After the tour is over, do you guys have any plans on any kind of new music, a new record, or are you working on some solo stuff at all? Or?
Well, I mean, we actually just finished up, I don't know if I'm at liberty to say exactly what it is, but a record of new music. It should hit in the fall.
Okay.
And it came out really, really cool. We did pretty much all of it recording on the road.
Oh, wow.
On different stages and on the bus and in hotel rooms. And it came out really, really great. So be on the lookout for that. And I have a original band project with a couple of the guys from the Doobie Brothers called Button.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, and, you know, that can be found on all the usual suspects, iTunes. The only thing is, I think there's another band called Button. It's like an electronic music group out of England or something.
Oh, okay.
Ours is a black and white album cover with a guy walking a cat on a leash.
Okay, I'll have to check that out then, because I've never even heard of that project.
Yeah, no, it's really cool. It's me, John Cowan, Ed Toth, and those two guys are in the Doobies. And it was really an interesting project because the way, you know, it's like what you're talking about. I've got a studio in my basement.
Yeah.
We toured together, you know, Chicago and the Doobies, and we realized we all lived in Nashville. So we got together at my house, and we basically just kind of jammed for an afternoon and recorded the whole thing. And then we went back and listened to what we did, and we just kind of went through and went, okay, there's a song, there's a song, there's a song, there's a song. And then we sort of fleshed them out, and we, you know, recorded it all old school, you know, no click tracks, no auto-tune, you know, just live performances, rhythm section all playing together. Even a lot of the guitar solos were live, not even overdubbed. But really cool. It's really cool stuff. It's sort of, I don't know if I'd call it prog rock or jam bands, or it's tough to hear it.
Okay.
But John Cowan is just a freak of nature vocally, so it was really easy to build around that.
Yeah, that's sweet. I'm definitely looking forward to checking that out now then.
Yeah, enjoy it. It's, like I said, I think it's on, you can find it on YouTube and Apple Music and Spotify and wherever.
Cool. I still jam to hard copies of things. I'm not too big on digital stuff, so I usually seek out a hard copy of music.
Yeah, we haven't pressed the record on vinyl yet, but now that you mentioned it, I'm starting to think maybe that might be a cool thing to do.
Yeah.
Even if it's just a limited run just to have it.
Yeah, no doubt. But yeah, they've got great rates out there. There's a lot of people who do large amounts of pressing for not that much money, too. So.
Well.
Now, I know Walter Perezader, he recently, he was having some health issues. Is he officially retired from Chicago?
Well, I don't know if they're ever going to say he's officially retired from Chicago. He's obviously a huge part of what this band. He was the one that started.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, as far as being able to come out on tour, now his health conditions won't really allow him to do that. You know, will he maybe show up for a TV performance or a one somewhere? Yeah, that's entirely possible. But, you know, as it stands now, and it's kind of funny when I see people talk about, you know, oh, well, you guys only have three original members in the band left. And it's like, well, you know how many bands are on the road with one or none? And the three that we have, Robert Lamb, Jimmy Pankow, and Lee Rothman, you know, the bulk of the music that we perform live every night was written by both Robert and Jimmy.
Yeah.
And Lee as well. So it's like, you know,
that's kind of like
a pretty important guy.
Right, and that's kind of like what I was saying earlier, dude. If you want to be like that about it, Chicago was over when Terry Capp died. But that's obviously not the case. Chicago is an entity. It's the same thing like when, you know, and sadly, when Jay Giles passed away, it's when the Jay Giles band, they wanted to take the Jay Giles band on the road. Jay Giles wasn't in the best of health, but they wanted to continue without him, and he tried, you know, there were some legal issues, but regardless, their argument was the Jay Giles band was about the music. It was about the energy and performance that they bring to the stage, and it wasn't necessarily about one person, even though it was named after their guitar player. But it's the same thing with Chicago. I never got to see Terry Kath play guitar because I wasn't born yet, but every show that I've seen with Chicago, you know, six times now, mind-boggling how good the band is live. So that's the band to me. That's who Chicago is. On those records, yes, they were this group, this core of guys who came together and changed rock and roll. But when I see them live, it's a completely different entity, and that's where it's at. So I always get a little bugged out when people talk about stuff like that, because it's like, okay, you clearly don't like live music. Because if you've ever seen Chicago, you know they freaking bring it every single time.
Well, hey, you know what? I've been a Kansas City Chiefs fan for 30 years. And when I first started watching those Chiefs games, I think Joe Montana was the quarterback. He had just come over from San Francisco.
Marcus
Allen, the running back. There's not one guy on that team anymore that I watched when I first became a fan of the Kansas City Chiefs.
Right.
But I'm still a fan. I still love watching their football game.
Yeah, exactly.
So, you know that's you know, Chicago, we're lucky to have you know, three original guys in the band. And
yeah.
And we're performing music as well as, you know, I think we ever have.
I totally agree. Yeah, I've never been disappointed any time I've ever seen you guys live, and definitely looking forward to the show this weekend, and hopefully much more shows to come as well in the future years as well. Thanks so much for taking the time out and talking to me while on tour, dude. It's seriously an honor to talk to you.
Hey, man. Well, good deal. We'll see you at Ravinia.
Yeah, absolutely, dude. Well, thanks again, and we'll be hopefully talking to you again soon.
Okay, cool. Appreciate it.